Hello and good morning, friends. Welcome to the CC Edusit Live Lecture. Dear friends, with our ongoing series on management accounting, today we would be discussing on how to calculate cash from operating activities in the first half, whereas in the second half, we would be discussing on how to calculate cash from investing and finance. And dear friends, we would like to tell you all that for this very discussion, we have once again with us in our studios, Dr. Amarjeet Kaur. Dr. Amarjeet Kaur is a professor of accounting and she's of a management school in one of the leading institution. She is a certified management accountant and she is certified from IMA USA. So dear friends, let's welcome our guest Dr. Amarjeet Kaur and let's try to grab maximum knowledge whatever she has experienced throughout her academic career. We believe that it would be very, very beneficial for us. So I would like to welcome our guest Dr. Amarjeet Kaur. Dr. Kaur, welcome to Data Set Lecture.
Thank you, Kitka. Thank you very much. A very good morning to you all, and at the outset, I would like to wish a very, very happy Diwali to all viewers. With these season's greetings, let's begin with module number 19, and the topic which we are continuing is how to prepare cash flow statement. And under that, in the module 19, the first half, we will talk about how to calculate cash from operating activities and followed by how to calculate cash from investing and financing activities for the purpose of preparing a cash flow statement. So if you could recall that in the last two modules last week, we discussed about how do we prepare cash flow statement. A cash flow statement basically is a tool to analyze the cash position of a business, especially for under three categories, that how much cash has been generated or used from business operations, how much cash has been generated or used from investing activities of a business, and third, that how much cash has been generated or used for financing activities of a business. So primarily there are three categories for the purpose of preparing cash flow statement, and this is a very important tool if we want to analyze in depth, if we want to carry in depth analysis of financial statement of a business. Now let's begin with the first one, how to calculate cash from operation. This is section A. So, as per the revised accounting standard and the prescribed format, a cash flow statement has three parts known as A, B, C. A denotes cash from operating activities, and that's what we are talking right away. So, as per this section A, the cash has to be calculated that how much cash has actually been generated from business operation. Now, friends, I believe you would understand that our financial statement, the balance sheet and statement of profit and loss account are not prepared on cash basis. They are prepared on, I hope you would be able to remember and recall that they are prepared on accrual basis. So, it is not important whether the cash has been paid or not, or payments have been received or not. We prepare our financial statements, both balance sheet and statement of profit and loss, based on accruals, which means if I have to analyze how much cash has been generated out of business operation, I need to adjust for all those items which are not based on cash. For example, we do not pay anything though we show depreciation as a major expenditure in our books of accounts. In statement of profit and loss account, depreciation is subtracted out of the revenue to calculate income for the year, so that we decide our tax liability. So the point I'm trying to make is this, that there could be many more such items which are though shown in the debit side of statement of profit or loss or are subtracted from revenue to calculate income. There could be few items which are though added as revenue, but they may not be in the form of cash. Other than this, there could be items which are known as non-operating items and are not, supposed to be there for the purpose of calculating cash from operating activities. So with this discussion, I hope you are with me. It means there are two items. One, non-operating items, another is non-cash items, which are adjusted in the income given in statement of profit or loss to calculate, net cash received or used from business operations or operating activities. That is section A of the prescribed format of cash flow statement, right? So, what do we begin with? For the purpose of preparing cash flow statement, the first section, cash from operating income, we start with a net income or loss as per your income statement, but after adding back any provision created for taxation or any extraordinary item which has been subtracted. So, if we have created, for example, provisions for dividend and provision for taxation both, and then thereafter we are showing our net income. So, in that case, we needed to add back both the items, and that becomes our net income before extraordinary items and before taxation. So, that is the beginning point. So, the first value which we begin with is this. Now, followed by the adjustments for non-cash items and non-operating items. As I just discussed, depreciation is the most important non-cash item. We do not pay this to anyone in outside. The amount remains with us. So, we have just to add back whatever we have charged in our books of account. Other than that, any amortization charges, which is very much like depreciation, but depreciation is considered or with reference to fixed assets which are of tangible nature. Amortization charges are, writing off the value of any fixed asset, but which is of intangible nature. So, it means depreciation is charged on fixed asset of tangible, whereas amortization word is used, which is very much like depreciation only, but for the assets which are of intangible nature, like, goodwill, like your copyrights or anything of such nature. Other than that, we could have, some non-operating item. Let's say we sold off some plant, machinery, building, any item in this year, and we earned profit, or we may incur loss on sale of fixed assets such as. So, both profit or loss, they are basically something which are not from business operation. They are from non-business or non-operating activity. So, we need to adjust for such profit or loss to calculate our fund from business operations or cash from business operations. Here, fund is cash, right? Fund could be treated as cash, fund could be treated as working capital, fund could be treated as working capital, both net or gross. So, many meanings of fund. So, here when I am using the word fund, it is pertaining to cash and its equivalent. So, that is what we do with non-cash items and non-operating items. So, carrying this discussion further, if there is a profit on sale of fixed asset, what does it mean? It means it has been added in the revenue of this year to calculate net income for the year. So, we need to subtract it, and had there been some loss on sale of fixed asset, we must have subtracted to calculate net income, as per our income statement. So, that loss would be added back. So, if something has been subtracted as loss, would be added back. Some profit which has been added in the revenue would be subtracted. Reason I have already explained being they both are not the items pertaining to business operations, rather they are non-operating revenues. Same way, we may have received some rent, we may have received some commission. So, they are considered as non-operating items. If we have transferred our profit to general reserve, to some other reserve fund, that is also the appropriation of profit, and that is not something operating activity. No expenditure is there, for business operations. So we need to take care of all these items to calculate cash from operating activities. Now we will understand this concept with the help of one small caselet. So let's have a look at the slide in front of you. This says find out cash from operations. The caselet is the net income for the year was rupees 1,10,000 and depreciation on fixed asset was 44,000. Extract of balance sheet are given below. So you have been given three columns here in this question. The first column says particulars. In the particulars, we have cash, debtors, investors, and prepaid expenses, accounts payable. These items are there. And then we have values given against these items. So we have been given, if you look at, the second column, this says closing balance. My cursor is showing that. So the closing balance for cash was 1,30,000. Closing balance for debtors was 2 lakhs. Closing balance for inventories was 2,90,000. Closing balance for prepaid expenses was 15,000. And the closing balance for accounts payable was 1,02,000. We have been given the opening balance for all the items. Cash, it was 1,40,000. Debtors 1,80,000. Inventories 3 lakhs. Prepaid expenses are given 16,000. And then we have been given accounts payable 1,16,000. So thus we have been given 5 items. This is just an extract. So 5 items and their values in the opening and the closing side. So the opening value if I take of cash is 140 and 130,000 in the closing. So before I proceed that how we should be calculating cash from operating activities, just consider that all the adjustment whatever I'm referring are for all the items but for cash. So it means excluding cash, we have to adjust for non-current and non-assets and non-current liabilities as well as operating, non-operating expenditure or revenues and also your any non-cash item. So this is the most important segment. I have seen students committing mistake or particularly in this section. The rest of the two section B and C are not that difficult. So please be with me and be careful. Kindly raise the question in between in case you have. So let's discuss now. So first point is that we have not to consider cash to begin with. Excluding cash, all another non-current assets and non-current cash assets other than cash which are of current nature and liabilities which are of current nature would be adjusted here, but not the cash. So why? Because we are actually working on to find out how the cash has changed from the previous year to this year. What were the parameters? What were the reasons that cash has changed? And then we are grouping those reasons into three categories. Cash is basically something which we are working at. So cash would be excluded and we would be working on the rest of the items than cash. So let's take the first item. This is debtors because cash is not to be included. Debtors were 1,80,000, right? And now they are 2 lakhs. So my question is whether debtors have increased or decreased. So obviously from 180,000 to 200,000, it means the debtors have increased. Now debtors are what? Debtors are current assets or current liabilities. Yes, you are right. They are current assets. So what we have to do, we have to adjust for current assets and current liabilities with the help of this formula, which is marked in red at the bottom. So if current assets are decreasing and current assets are increasing, the effect on cash is different. So current assets decreasing means your cash is increasing. Current assets increasing means your cash is decreasing. So here it is debtor, right? So if debtors are increasing means what? your current assets increasing, it means your net cash would go down by the amount, the difference of these two, which is 20,000, right? Now, inventories, the second item. So, inventories are there. So, inventories 3 lakhs, they were in the beginning, and now at the end, they are 2,90,000. Now, the question comes in, so they have gone down or gone up? You are right, they have gone down by 10,000. So, what is the rule? Inventories are current assets. The rule is, if current assets are decreasing, right, it means stock has been sold, isn't it? So how to interpret any decrease? That it means the cash is going to go up. So, decrease in current asset other than cash would be treated as increase in cash, right? The third item is prepaid expenses, and again they are current assets. So, current assets going down by 1,000, they were 16,000 in the beginning and now they are 15,000. So, current assets going down by 1,000, so it means it would be taken as decrease in current asset, and decrease in current asset means increase in cash, right? The last item is accounts payable, and just try to recall what they are. Accounts payables are obviously liabilities of current nature. So, they were 116,000 and now they are 102,000. So, there is a decline by 14,000. And what does the rule says? Rule says, if current liabilities are going up means my cash is decreasing. It means I have my current liability going down means I have paid for that. My books were showing my accounts payable 116,000. And now at the end of the year, my closing balance showing my accounts payable as 102,000. It means I have actually paid for accounts payable by the amount 14,000. Okay, so with this understanding in mind, so here is the beginning balance. The net income was 110,000, the first line of the question says, and depreciation on fixed asset was 44,000. So, how should we be preparing or calculating cash from operations? The section A. So, I am purposefully spending more time on this section because I have seen students committing a lot of mistake in this section. So, first of all, we have to begin with net income before tax and extraordinary items. So, how much is that? 110,000, right? So, kindly read this value as 110,000, not 11,000. So, 110,000 is the income before extraordinary items. After that, we have to make adjustment for. Kindly read this title carefully. It says adjustment for non-cash and non-operating items. So, in this small question, or rather an extract of the question, only item given here is depreciation, which is non-cash. So, this 44,000 would be added back in 110,000, and that would be adjustment for non-cash and non-operating item. Had some other exams, another item, we have been given amortization expenditure. We have been given other than depreciation, we have been given some item creating some other fund. So, they all would be added in this value 110,000, so that we reach to an amount known as operating profit before working capital changes. Kindly pay attention on the words I am using, operating profit, or you may like to say cash from operations before working capital adjustments. It means so far we have just taken the beginning balance of the profit or loss given in the books of accounts of the business, adjusted it for any tax amount or any non-cash or non-operating item, which is, for example, depreciation. It could be loss or profit on sale of any fixed asset, and that's what we have to do. After that, the amount which is known or which we arrive at is known as operating profit before working capital changes. So, after that, once we reach to that point, we are required to make changes in the working or make adjustment for changes in the working capital. And for that, we would be using the formula or the rule I just showed you here, marked in red. So this, kindly keep this rule in mind that whenever current assets are decreasing or current liabilities are increasing, we need to increase our cash, and vice versa. And current assets are increasing and current liabilities are decreasing, we would be, you know, decreasing our cash balance. So that's what we do with the current assets and current liability, but excluding your cash balance. So let's now have a look at the same question we were pursuing. After reaching to 110 plus 44, this amount would be 1,54,000, known as operating profit before working capital changes. Now we have to make changes for the working capital items other than cash. So the first item, you know, let's take all those items which are supposed to be added, and then followed by items which can be or which would be deducted. So let's take the first item here, inventory. Inventory was decreasing, so by 10,000, we just had a discussion on that. So inventory or stock decreasing means it has been sold off. So by how much amount? 10,000. So selling the amount for cash means my cash is going up, right? So that's why I am increasing my cash here under the category adjustment for current assets and current liabilities, wherein our stock is going up by 10,000. So I have a question to you. What would happen if the stock is being, you know, purchased? Stock being purchased in a year for cash, now condition is it should be for cash. If the stock is being purchased, means my stock would go up in the books of account, right? So stock going up means what? It would be increase in current asset. Increase in current asset means reduction in my cash. So we would have treated that increase in stock, you know, in a different manner or an adverse manner, while we are treating this decrease in inventory or stock, you know, as addition. We would have taken increase in stock as deletion or reduction in our cash balance, because we would be purchasing stock for cash, right? Followed by the next item given in the question, it was prepaid expenses. Now, if you remember, we had a discussion on the value given. Our prepaid expenses were going down by 1,000. So, prepaid expenses going down by 1,000 means again a current asset going down. So, my cash goes up. The moment my current asset goes down, my cash goes up. So that's why this decrease in prepaid expenses by 1,000 would be added to the cash balance reserve before adjustments in working capital, right? So this is a small question, as I said. So followed by, now we have to identify all those items which are reducing our cash balance. So the items which are reducing our cash balance are debtors and accounts payable. So both are, one is debtor. So debtors are what? Debtors are assets of current nature. So are they going down or they going up? Yeah, so I hope you noticed carefully. Debtors were going down by 20,000. So that is why we showed it in bracket. Any current asset, either debtor, inventory or any other current asset, going down means it is going to impact my cash, right? Stock going down, we just discussed a minute ago, means stock going down means what? Means I purchase stock. And if my stock going up, like here the debtors are going up, so increase in debtors means I have paid or not paid. Increase in debtors in my books means I was supposed to collect. They are not creditor. I'm trying to, you know, test your knowledge here. Debtors means the people whom from we have to collect, right, from whom we have to collect, means they were supposed to pay us. And if they have not paid us, only that is the condition where our debtors in our books would be showing an upward value. So here in this given example, the debtors have gone up by 20,000. It means my cash could not be collected for that value, and that is why I would be showing this 20,000 as reduction in cash and would be shown as in value in bracket. Hope you are with me, right? This was just to, you know, shake your mind. The next thing was accounts payable. Now the accounts payables are liabilities. They were going up or they were going down. There was a decrease in accounts payable. Now let's have a look. Accounts payable are what? They are the outcome of our credit sales. People who were supposed to pay us, right? They are known as what? Accounts receivables. And the people to whom we have to pay. You know, if we are buying on credit, so this is considered as accounts payable. So if we are buying any supplies for the production and we are buying on credit, that's what is our accounts payable. If we paid, means our accounts payable has decreased, right? Earlier they were X amount, now they are Y amount. So if the amount has gone down against accounts payable, means I paid. That's how the accounts payable would be, you know, going down. So accounts payables are what? They are current liabilities, outcome of our credit purchases for supplies, and reduction in them means we are paying to our creditors, which are the outcome of our credit purchases, which means leading to reduction in my cash. So that's why in this example, we are reducing this cash balance by the amount here, 14,000. Okay. So the total of these four items, where 11,000 are increase, and this 20 plus 14, 34,000 is decrease. So the net increase or decrease is to be taken in the outer column. This last column is known as outer column. So the net effect of these adjustment in working capital is negative. It means my cash balance in this, as per the data given in this caselet, would go down by 23,000, which is 34,000 minus 11,000. I hope you are with me. So if we subtract this 23,000, because this is a negative value, out of this 1,54,000, our net cash from operation comes as 1,31,000. So that's how we calculate cash from business operating activities for the purpose of preparing cash flow statement. I hope you could comprehend it well. This was a little, you know, complex, though we took very limited number of adjustment so that we could cover in half an hour and I could help you to understand well. So I hope the purpose has been solved. Thank you so very much for being with me for this half an hour. Thank you. Good afternoon, friends. This is module 20 in management accounting, and we will talk about how to find out or calculate cash from investing and financing activities while preparing a cash flow statement. So as we know, cash flow statement is a very important tool to analyze cash and its flow while preparing cash flow statement. We have to take care of three items. One is cash flow from operations, which we discussed in the previous module, module number 19. And the second is section B of the cash flow statement of the prescribed format to calculate or to find out cash from investing activities. And the last section of a cash flow statement is your cash from financing activities. So in this module, we are just targeting the remaining two sections, which is B and C, because first section has already been discussed in the previous module in this regard. So, let's begin with section B, which is cash from investing activities. So what is investment for a business? For a business, investment is, you know, if you are, if you are a business and you are buying share of XYZ company, you are a business, but on behalf of the business, in the name of the company, if it is a company, you are buying debentures of other company. You are a business and you are opening an FD with a bank. You are opening an FD with, say, post office. So that is what? That is, you know, they are the examples of investments made by a business in other businesses, right? So that's what investment is. But that's not all. You as a business, if you are buying building, you are buying land, you are buying equipments, right? Even that is investment. But that is all the examples I just, you know, took. They are one side of investment. Investment has two sides. Investment has, you know, one is you are investing in and the cash is going out. You are investing for cash. This is the assumption. Another is you are recovering from the investments you made. Either you are receiving, you know, dividend, or you are receiving interest on the FD you opened with the bank account, or you are receiving interest on the debentures. You are receiving, you know, any kind of income on the investment. In case you have invested in a building and now you are, you know, you are not using that building for the purpose of business, but you have rented it out. So you are receiving rent on the building. So building is an investment for the business, and rent received is an income for the business, right? So the two aspects, cash received or spent for buying or selling, you know, respectively, of any of the fixed asset which is of non-current nature. Kindly mark my words, in this section we are addressing all those assets, you know, which are not of recurring or not of current nature. We call them as NCAs, non-current assets. Why? Because current assets, all other than cash, have already been discussed and addressed, covered in the first section, section A, in this regard. And now we are talking about section B, and where we would be addressing, you know, or dealing with all non-current assets, whether being received or purchased. As I just said, that the cash would be received if the current assets are sold, right? Cash would be received if some income on the non-current assets have been received, right? Cash would be used if non-current assets are purchased. For example, building, land, machinery, plant, car, vehicles, anything for the business. So this is what this section addresses. It means, so we are just addressing non-current assets in this section. Okay, so to understand this better, we will be using a case. But I am going to use the case to address all the three sections. Comprehensive case is there. So let me just discuss how do we deal with cash from financing as well. So that after the theoretical or conceptual discussion, we would just go straight to a case in this regard. So now the third and the last section, section C. Section C deals with, you know, how much cash has been generated or used, you know, source or use of cash because of financing activities. So the financing activities deal with the third, you know, and the remaining part of the balance sheet, third item, you know, of the total final accounts, which is non-current liabilities. So if you remember, current assets have already been discussed in the first section. I just discussed a minute ago non-current assets in section B, and now I am talking the section C, which is financing activities, and here we deal all those items which pertain to liabilities but of non-current nature. It means fixed liabilities. In other way, you may call them as fixed liabilities. Fixed liabilities are what? You raised equity shares this year. That increase in equity share, if you raise them for cash, they will affect your cash balance. You redeemed preference share. So what they are? They are non-current liabilities for the business, right? They are liabilities and of non-current nature. So if we have paid for them, it becomes what? It becomes an item of you know, where cash has been utilized to pay off your non-current liability. Same way, you know, we may pay term loan which was taken for the purpose of financing your needs, right? So term loan was a long-term liability for the business. If we paid off, so our cash will go out. If we raised a term loan this year, like we raised debenture, we can raise debenture, we can raise term loan, or any other form of debt instrument can be used. So if we are raising funds by using any of the format of debt instrument, then our cash would be going up. But the condition is that we should be raising this loan or raising these debentures in lieu of cash, not for any other item than cash. Only then our cash would be affected. Otherwise, our cash will not be affected. So, one non-current liability and the cash, which is a current asset, is affected. So, one current item, another non-current item would be affecting my cash balance. Otherwise, it will not be getting affected or there won't be any change. And we are considering change, the movement of cash, because of financing activities. So, these are the items. How about dividend paid? You know, dividend received, I just discussed, is your income if you have invested somewhere, and that goes to section B, right? What about dividend paid? Now, you as a business, as a company, would be paying dividend to whom? To your shareholders, isn't it? So, if you are paying dividend, means your cash is going out, right? And that would be treated here as an activity of financing nature, and it goes in section 3. So, hope you are with me with the primary discussion on this. Now, we will be taking a case. So, let's have a look at the data here in front of me. This is a case showing a balance sheet of 2 years, 2001 and 2002. So, we have in the liability side, we have share capital. So, be careful whenever you have been given or you deal with such cases or situations, be careful while reading the data. So, at the top, the first line in the dark blue color, it is, you know, 2001 is on the inner column and, you know, in the third column, and 2002 is on the left hand side, in the second column. So, be very careful because there's no fixed, you know, guideline that we should be showing the current year in this side or the previous year on this side. So be careful while reading the case. So 2001, because we have to register change, that's why it's important that we put a lot of effort and while reading that data belongs to which year. Careful reading is needed. So 2001, our share capital was 8 lakh. It has gone up to 10 lakhs in 2002. Our reserve, they were 1,50,000 in 2001, and now they are 2 lakhs. So there's an upward change, 50,000 increase, which means that goes to generating or calculating cash from business operation. This is a reserve created out of profits of the current year. So this item goes to the section A of the cash flow statement. Then we have balance of profit and loss account. It was 60,000 and now it is 1 lakh. So it means we have in this current year earned 40,000. Debentures were nil and now they are 2 lakhs. It means all debentures have been raised in this current year only. Then we have provision for taxation, 70,000 in the current year, in the previous year, and now they have gone up by 30,000. That's why the provisions are 1 lakh this year. This proposed dividend was 1 lakh and now it is 2 lakhs. So there's an increase by 1 lakh rupees. Sundry creditors is the last item given. 820 were in 2001 and 700,000 are in the current year. So total of the liability side was 20 lakh in 2001, 25 lakhs in 2002. If we refer to asset side, plant and machinery was 5 lakhs and now they are 7 lakhs. Land and building was 4 lakhs and now they are 6 lakhs. There was no investment, but it means this 1 lakh of investment has been made in the current year and this is an item of investing. So sundry debtors were 7 lakhs and now they are 5 lakhs. So it means debtors have gone down. Stock was 2 lakh and now it is 4 lakh. It has gone up. Cash on hand was 2 lakh and there is no change. It is 2 lakh only. The total is 25 lakhs and 20 lakhs respectively for 2002 and 2001. Other than that, there are few items given, additional information. Depreciation has been charged 25% on the opening value of plant and machinery. So kindly be careful, this value has to be charged. Generally, it is on the previous year's balance. You need to read the question very carefully. It could be given either way. During the year, one old machinery costing 80,000. And the WDV, the return down value 20,000, was sold for 35,000. And the 50,000 was paid towards the taxation for the current year. And building under construction was not subject to any depreciation. Okay. So now let's see how should we be calculating cash from operations quickly. And then we would discuss how do we calculate cash from investing and financing activities. First of all, just have a look. We have to begin with net profit before tax and extraordinary item. Where does this amount 3,20,000 comes from? So go back to the question. You can note down the values. So we have profit for the current year, 40,000, 60 and the current year 1 lakh. It means the increase in this profit and loss account by 40,000 is the amount 40,000 as profit earned in the current year. So that's what you have earned. So 40,000 would be adjusted for any non-cash item, any tax item or any item which is of extraordinary item. So how much provisions have been created for tax we need to calculate. So if you remember, we discussed this item to how to prepare a tax account to find out how much has been created in this year, but quickly. So just have a look. If the tax amount was 1 lakh, right, or is current year, it is 1 lakh closing balance of the provisions. After paying 50,000, the third item given here, my cursor is showing that. So it means you have spent 50,000 and you have in your hand 1 lakh. So it means 150,000 is the total amount used. But out of that, 70,000 was the only amount which was available in the beginning. It means 150 minus 70. 80,000 is what you have charged from current year profit. So I'm using a very, very layman approach without making an account. But that is very, very helpful. So kindly remember it this way and it really helps because I have seen people committing mistakes while preparing, account for provision on taxes or dividend. So the amount which is there as a closing balance, 1 lakh plus whatever you have paid, 50,000 minus whatever was there in the beginning gives you 80,000. So 80,000 would be added to the profit of the current year, 40,000. It makes it 1,20,000. And where does that 2 lakhs come additional, because the amount shown is 3,20,000 before extraordinary item, before taxation. So 2 lakh is the amount which you have created out of the provisions, out of the profit of the current year as provision for dividend. So those 2 lakhs would be added and that makes it 3,20,000, the amount to begin with for calculating cash from business operations, section A of the cash flow statement. So have a look here. So 320 is the amount which I discussed, that how did we reach to that amount. Now this amount would be adjusted for whatever has been transferred to general reserves, which is 50,000. I discussed a minute ago. In that, we would be adding depreciation which has been charged 1,25,000. The percentage is given and we have calculated on the beginning value of the asset. And then we would be subtracting the profit earned on sale of machinery. How do we calculate that profit? Here, look at the question. WD value was 20,000, right? And written down value is 20,000 and you have sold it for 35,000. So it means you have incurred a loss of 15,000. So we would be subtracting. Your books were showing the asset as 20,000, right? And we are selling it for 35,000. It means we have earned profit, not loss. We have earned profit for 15,000, and profit is a non-operating item, so would be subtracted. Any item shown in bracket, as it has been done here, would be treated as an item which is to be subtracted. So 15,000 are subtracted to calculate cash from operations. So this value after making these three adjustments is 4,80,000 and known as operating profit before working capital changes, right? After that, we will make adjustments for current assets. So working capital is current assets and current liability both. So increase in stock would be subtracted. I won't be spending much time. We discussed about it. So increase in stock is subtracted. That's why it is in bracket. Decrease in debtor is going to be added as it is a current asset and is going down. It means my debtors have paid me. So 2 lakhs would be added. Decrease in creditors, it means I have paid to my creditors and it would be taken as outflow of the cash will go down, so 1,20,000. We will take it as another item, decrease in creditor has been taken. After that, we would find out how much cash is generated from operations but without adjusting the tax paid, so it comes out to be 360. That's why this amount is in bold. And after this, now whatever the tax has been paid for the current year, which is 50,000, that amount would be subtracted and the difference is 3,10,000. So if you just have a look, here is rupee. So this is a separate column and this is a separate column. So this column has been used to calculate net cash from operating activities. Kindly follow my cursor, and the net amount of cash from business operations is shown in the outer column. That's the only amount I am showing in the outer column. Now let's go further. From the same question, we are calculating cash from financing and investing activities. So investing activity has to be shown in order number 2, if you refer to the prescribed format, and that's why we are just showing them in section B here. So have a look at the slide. How we are calculating cash from investing activities, we have few items only in this question. We purchased fixed asset and by 3,45,000. How do I calculate that amount? So the question is in front of you. Purchase of fixed asset. So it means you have to go to the asset side. Plant and machinery 5 lakhs to 7 lakh. Land and building 4 lakh to 2 lakhs. Right? So we have to make an account of plant and machinery where we need to make adjustments for the depreciation, and then we have to calculate the amount of the how much we have been spent either on purchasing or how much we have received out of selling. So the first thing is purchase, which has been calculated by making the account 3,45,000. Since it is a purchase, means cash is going out of the business, so we are putting it in the bracket. Okay, the next item we are treating is the building. So the building is again, if you refer, it was 4 lakh and now it is 6 lakhs. It means, and the information here says building is under construction. It means we have spent 2 lakh to construct the part of the building which is under construction, though not finished. So whatever has been spent on construction this year would be taken as outflow of cash under investing activities, because your building is the investment for the business. So 2 lakh, that's why has been shown in the bracket. The next item, if you remember, we have investments which were not there at all in 2001 and now they are there in 2002. So it means you have invested in somewhere else, in some other business. So this 1 lakh would be taken as outflow of cash to purchase those investments, right? So this would be shown in bracket as has been shown for building and as has been shown for fixed asset. After that, if you remember, we just had one item shown in the question, that old machine has been sold for 35,000. So selling the machine for 35,000, we adjusted the profit on sale of this machine in the operating section, in the first section. But how about the amount which has actually been received, 35,000? This 35,000 is the amount which is actually received out of the sale, a sale proceed, you know, of the machine sold. So it would be treated as a receipt of cash under investing activity. So it would be shown in a as an inflow. So no need of putting a bracket, because this is an inflow. So there were three items as outflow. This is the only item, one item as inflow. So if we adjust all the four items, you know, plus and minus, you know, if you adjust them, the net effect of investing is coming out to be 6,10,000. You can have a look at the slide. So this outer column is showing 6,10,000 as the net cash used under the investing activities. Right, which is, so these three items have been summed up together, 345 plus 2 plus 1 lakh, so which gives you 3 plus 2 plus 1, 6,45,000 minus this 35, because 35,000 is plus and rest of the item is minus, so which means outflow. So the net impact or net cash used in investing is in outflow, in negative form, which would be treated as outflow. So 6,10,000 comes out to be the amount. Now we would be dealing with the last section, which is cash from financing activities. Just have a look here. Now we need to refer to the question and find out how many items are there in liability section, because I stressed it very carefully that last section, this is a financing section, deals with liabilities only of non-current nature. So if you have a look at the question and if you look at the liability side, there was a first item, share capital, which was 8 lakh and now it is 2 lakh. It means the share capital has been issued, right? So issued means the cash has been received by 2 lakh. So this would be taken as inflow or a positive item under financing last section. Now let's have a look on the same thing. We have second item in debentures. So this debenture here, this is a non-current liability, so NCL. So non-current liability, it was nil in the previous year and now they had 2 lakhs. So again, this would be treated as item which has been, where the debentures have been raised. So as an inflow of the cash under financing activity. So, is there any other item? Did we pay dividend or not? We have nothing been given in the information that either any dividend had been paid or not. Just have a look. There are four information. First is depreciation. Second is about the sale of machinery. Third is about the income tax. And the fourth one was about building. But nothing is been given about the dividend. Now, under such situation, when nothing is been given, that how much has been paid or created, how do we deal with this? I would like to discuss for a minute here. If only two items are given against provision for dividend, so the previous year value of dividend, which is 1 lakh here, is treated as been created, right? And the current year value is been treated as been paid, right? So 1 lakh the previous year is the amount which would be treated as something we have paid. I think I should correct if I have said it otherwise. So 1 lakh is the amount which is from the previous year would be taken as paid, and the current year value is 2 lakh which would be taken as made. So provision made and provision paid, right? So that's why if you look at the solution, we are showing 1 lakh dividend paid, which is from the previous year. So in all there are 3 items: 2 lakhs which was issue of share capital is an inflow of cash, so our cash balance will go up. Then we have debentures which have been issued and the value is again 2 lakh. This was just a coincidence, the values are same in both the items. And the last item, dividend paid, is the amount given in the 2001, the year 2001. So the previous year value would be taken as paid, and the current year value would be taken as made, the provision made. That is why that 2 lakh amount which was provision made was added to calculate cash, you know, from before extraordinary item and before taxation. That was our beginning point to solve or to address this case. So I hope you could comprehend this section well. Now what do we do? After this there are 3 items: 2 lakh from share capital, 2 lakh from debentures, that is the inflow, and we are paying 1 lakh as dividend. It means 2 plus 2 share capital plus debenture issued, 4 lakh minus 1 lakh dividend paid. So 4 minus 1, 3 lakh is the net inflow of cash under financing activities. So it means now we have total 3 values. The first value, the section A, if you have a look here, 3,10,000, this was from the, section A. I am showing it, my cursor, just kindly follow my cursor at the top of the slide. Section A shows cash from operating activities, and the value we calculated was 3,10,000, followed by section B. Right, I have purposefully have put them in different colors so that you could differentiate. The section B, here the value calculated was in minus. It means there was an outflow, or you may say use of cash for investing activities, which is a negative value. And the third is now section C here, and here the net cash flow is positive and the amount coming out is 3 lakhs. So 3 items. In total, 3,10,000, 6,10,000 and 3 lakhs in A, B, C. Now, after this, what do we do? We add A plus B plus C. So, here, have a look. This increase in cash and cash equivalents is shown as A plus B, which is coming out to be nil. How nil? Your A section was showing a positive value of 3,10,000. C section is also showing a positive value of 3 lakhs. So 3 lakhs plus 3,10,000 means 6,10,000, whereas your section B was showing a negative value of 6,10,000. So plus minus equal, it means the net effect of A plus B plus C is 0. And now we know the reason of not having any change in cash in this current year is this. So operating section is contributed, investing section contributed, so was the financing section. But now we know the effect on change on cash from previous year to this year with their reason under this section. That's why we use this tool, very important tool for analyzing the cash condition. So what do we do after having this value as nil? So now we add the opening balance of the cash, which was 2 lakh in this case, and then we end up nil plus 2 lakh means 2 lakh. So that is your ending value. So that's how we prepare cash flow statement. I hope you could comprehend this well with the help of the case we used. This was a very good case to the best of my understanding. So thank you so very much for your attention.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you so very much for your inputs to the lecture. And we believe that all the students would be benefited from this particular lecture. So, dear friends, whatever being taught to you, please thoroughly go through the lecture, as the lecture is going to be uploaded on YouTube for you very soon. So, keep watching the lectures. And afterwards, if you feel that there is something which is required to be answered, that could be mailed to us at info.cc@nic.in. We would be meeting again very soon and would be continuing our series on management accounting. Till then, take care. Goodbye. Thank you, ma'am. Thank you so very much.
Thank you, Gitika, and thank you, viewers.